My name is Virginia Reed Murphy, and I live in San Jose, California. I have led a pretty comfortable life, but in 1846, I lived through quite an adventure. I was the oldest of four children, and my family, the Reeds, set out from Springfield, Illinois, to California. Did you ever hear tell of sweet Betsy of Pike, who crossed the wide prairies with her lover Ike, with two yoke of oxen, a big yellow dog, a tall Shanghai rooster, and one spotted hog? Hoodle-dang-fal-de-di-doo, hoodle-dang-fal-de-day. I think of my adventure every time I hear that song, but it does not tell my story. Our family consisted of my parents, James and Margaret Reed, my grandma, my sister Patty, 8, and brothers Jimmy, 5, and Tommy, 3. I turned 13 on the prairie. Grandma was bedridden, but she insisted on coming with us because she could not abide being without her only daughter, and she had a son already in California. Even though my actual father died when I was an infant, when Mama married James Fraser Reed, he became my true papa. We had our cook, Eliza, and several hired men to help us herd the cattle and drive our 3 wagons, including Milt Elliott, who had worked for Pa a long time and called my mother Ma. Pa's furniture shop made a wagon so large and comfortable it was later called the Pioneer Palace Car. It had an entrance on the side, and opposite hung a full-length mirror. It had beds for everyone, and a wood-burning stove carefully vented through the canvas. We never thought this wagon might be harder to pull over mountains or through narrow spots, nor that it might make others jealous of our comfort, but it did all that. The George and Jacob Donner families decided to go with us to California. We all had comfortable lives in Illinois. My father had a good furniture shop, and the Donners were successful farmers. So why did we leave family and friends to take a 6-month trip full of hardship and danger? My mother had always had poor health, and we thought the climate in California would be better for her. The Donners had already moved several times, each time further west, so it was not unusual for them. The single men who drove our cattle and wagons went for promises of good jobs and cheap farmland in the west. Our cook Eliza, who at 31 was considered an old maid, she heard there were 100 men to each woman out there. Everyone had their reasons. In those years, this trip was a difficult thing to do, but hundreds have gone before us in the past 3 years on the Oregon and California Trail. This was before the gold rush, and there were no roads, no signs, no bridges, and virtually no maps. There were, however, several new cutoffs from the old trail, all guaranteed to be shorter and easier. One such was the Hastings Cutoff, advertised by a Mr. Lansford Hastings in a pamphlet called The Emigrant's Guide to Oregon and California. It was a very popular pamphlet and made the West sound like paradise for everyone. The trouble was, no one, not even Mr. Hastings himself, had ever taken this cutoff. The Donners traveled with us through heavy rain to Independence, Missouri, where the trail west commenced and civilization ended. With our 3 wagons, we had 50 head of cattle, extra oxen, horses, and 5 dogs, including the family terrier, Cash. Pa rode his thoroughbred mare, and I had my wonderful pony, Billy, which he had given me, and I dreamed of riding him all the way to the west. George and Tamzine Donner had 5 daughters. Aunt Tamzine was a teacher and brought many books, as she planned to open a seminary for young ladies in California. Leanna Donner was about my age. George's brother Jacob and his wife Elizabeth had 7 children. In late May, we joined a large wagon train guided by amiable Captain Russell. To my young mind, the trip was not too difficult, and at times quite interesting. So many animals I had never seen. Buffalo and antelope, prairie dogs and grouse. As Tamzine Donner wrote her sister, "If we have no more difficulty than now, I shall say the hardest part is getting started." The grass was still green, and there were wildflowers all about. Aunt Tamzine knew about plants, and she could tell you the names of them all. She painted watercolors of black-eyed Susan, delphinium, penstemon. Often Ma would invite other ladies to sit in our Pioneer Palace car and sew and share good gossip. In the mornings, Papa and I would ride ahead to find a good place to camp that night. How I enjoyed riding my pony Billy, galloping over the plain, my hair flowing in the wind. I rode with some of the hunting parties, but Pa would not allow me to carry a rifle. We roasted what was shot on the campfire. You know, buffalo meat is pretty good. At night, folks would gather about the campfire, chatting merrily, and often a song would be heard. Mr. Breen might play his fiddle, or Patrick Dolan would give us an Irish jig on the hind gate of a wagon.
One evening, quite early, they camped on the plat. 'Twas near by the trail on a shady green flat, where Betsy, quite tired, lay down to repose, while I gazed with wonder at his Pike County rose. Hoodle-dang-fall-dee-dye-do, hoodle-dang-fall-dee-day.
Families kept joining the wagon train along the Platte River. Lavina Murphy was a widow from Tennessee with 7 children and 3 grandchildren. Her 2 oldest daughters had married a few years earlier, so their husbands and little children, the Pikes and the Fosters, joined the family venture. They were a close clan of 13. Lemmy Murphy was about my age, but it was Sarah Murphy Foster, the mother of a beautiful baby boy, who I became close friends with. Young William Eddy had a sweet wife and 2 children. He was a carriage maker and a good and generous hunter. I also became close to the Breens, a farming family who had come from Iowa, and before that, Ireland. They had 7 boys and only 1 baby girl. That is why Mrs. Breen liked me so much. Eddie Breen, who was my age, rode horses with Patty and me. There were also several Germans, both young couples and single men. They mostly kept to themselves and spoke their own language, which I did not understand. There were other single men, many hired as teamsters for others. Their job was to herd cattle or walk alongside the wagons driving the oxen with their whips. Because of all the rain, the rivers were flooded. We had to build rafts and set up a rope to pull us across the river, 1 wagon at a time. Folks heading east would deliver letters we wrote along the trail, and this is the first letter I wrote back to my cousin in Illinois. "My dear Mary, I want to tell you Grandma died. We made a neat coffin and buried her under a tree very decent. Every time we come into the wagon, we look at her bed for her. We miss her very much. Your cousin, Virginia." Later, I thought it best Grandma died before our trials began. Wagons join and left our caravan all along the trail. One of the single men, Charles Stanton, rode often to his brother back east. He described a group of wagons bound for Oregon. 20 wagons concluded to withdraw from our party and go on their own hook. In their party, there were many young ladies. In ours, mostly young men. Friendships and attachments had been formed, which were hard to break. Ever since, our company is nearly deserted by the young men every day, riding out on horseback, pretending to hunt, but instead pursuing the fair Oregon girls. Papa wrote to his brother-in-law, "My first appearance on the wilds of Nebraska as a hunter gave me a splendid 2-year-old elk, the first one killed by the caravan as yet. It was the largest I ever beheld. We are 200 miles from Fort Laramie, where we intend to stop and repair our wagon wheels. They are nearly all loose. Aunt Tamzine Donner wrote to a friend in Springfield. Wood now is very scarce, but buffalo chips are excellent. They kindle quick and retain heat surprisingly. George Donner is himself yet. He crows in the morning and shouts, "Chain up, boys, chain up," with as much authority as though he was something in particular. We have the best of people in our company, and some, too, that are not so good. George Donner wrote a friend. 200 Sioux are expected at the fort today, on the way to join the warriors in the war against the Crows. The Indians all speak friendly to us. Two braves breakfasted with us. Their ornaments were tastefully arranged, consisting of beads, feathers, and a fine shell that is got from California. When I beheld Indians for the first time, I was quite frightened because of my grandmother's tales of scalping and kidnapping when she was young. But now I thought the Sioux were the prettiest dressed Indians there were. The Sioux fell in love with my pony, Billy, and set about bargaining to buy him. They brought a pile of buffalo robes and beautifully tanned buckskins, pretty beaded moccasins, and ropes made of grass. They placed these in a heap alongside several of their ponies. They made my father understand by signs they would give them all for Billy and his rider. Papa smiled and shook his head, and the number of ponies increased. After that, as long as the Sioux were on the trail with us, I was kept in the wagon. I was not pleased. The Indians would ride by our wagon often to see themselves in our mirror opposite the wagon's opening. Then I pulled out our spyglass and opened it with a click and sent them running. Then I was pleased. The Injuns came down in a wild yellin' horde, and Betsy was scared they would scalp her adored. Behind the front wagon wheel Betsy did crawl, and there she fought Injuns with musket and ball. Hoodle-dang-fall-dee-di-doo, hoodle-dang-fall-dee-day.